The second part of chapter 17 that I want to talk about is human evolution. I'm leaving out a variety of things because we're going to deal with some diversity labs later on, right at the end of our class. And so the evolution of animals in terms of human evolution, that I think is also one that's very important to us. So let's take a look at where we came from ultimately. And one of the things that I want to point out to you here is that this is not trying to say that humans evolved from chimpanzees, or that there's some kind of progression, or that somehow humans are the pinnacle of evolution. No, chimpanzees are just as much a pinnacle. They're just in a different part of the evolutionary tree. So where does this start? Well, we start with primates in general. Primates is a group of vertebrates. They are mammals, of course, and they evolved from insect-eating mammals in the late Cretaceous period. Now, the late Cretaceous, that was still very much the age of the dinosaurs. So mammals at that point in time really weren't very smart, very evolved. They were just sort of subsiding on eating some insects and crawling around in the bush, and hopefully they didn't get eaten by the dinosaurs. Dinosaurs were basically the big thing in those days. Now, the earliest ones of these were relatively small, and that was good because dinosaurs would tend to eat things that they could see easily or catch easily. And so one great strategy to avoid being eaten is to be relatively small and agile and arboreal, meaning you get up in the trees, where some of these dinosaurs, certainly the carnivorous dinosaurs, simply couldn't go. If you look at the key features of primates, you'll find that they had really good shoulder joints. If you look at other kinds of organisms, they don't really have very good shoulder joints. Our shoulder joints allow us to move our limbs to all kinds of interesting angles. So if you look at how your arms can move, you can move them sideways, you can move them forward, you can move them upward. I mean, you have really good flexibility in your shoulders. And if you stand in front of the mirror and you sort of look backward and see what your shoulder blades are doing, you can do all kinds of interesting gyrations just with your shoulder blades. So it's a very complex system, and if you are going to be in an arboreal environment, which is three-dimensional, then you need all that. You need to be able to grasp upwards and forwards and backwards and sideways, because that is what your environment requires. So that's clearly a great adaptation to have. Natural selection will favor those individuals who, in an arboreal environment, can move their shoulders any which way. Secondly, if you are going to move in such an environment, you need to have your eyes in front of the face, because that's the direction in which you're going. You don't need to have it on top of the face, because that's not really where the danger can come from, and that's not where you're moving. You'll find that organisms that are living pretty flat to the ground, or that are living along the seashore, they would tend to have their eyes closer to the top of the head, because that's where the danger could come from. But in this case, if you're going to move forward, you better have your eyes in front of the face. If you are also going to move through an arboreal environment, and of course this is the branch to branch and you know, Tarzan and the liana, that kind of thing, you need really good eye-hand coordination. And of course, if you think of eye-hand coordination, that is still something that in humans, probably more than in some of the other primates, we now use. I mean, typing skills, texting skills, all those are eye-to-hand coordination issues. Gaming, right? All of this is eye-to-hand coordination. You don't find any other organisms outside of primates that have that level of coordination. And then lastly, you have extensive parental care. We give a huge investment to our offspring. And this is the kind of thing that primates do in general. Primates don't just sort of drop their offspring off and then they leave. No, we actually have to deal with our offspring for a long time, because that is our primary investment. Now, here is a family tree of primates, very similar to the family tree of animals I showed you in the last section. And you can see on the right where everybody is, and who everybody is, I suppose. And you can also see how, in terms of timing, this whole tree may have grown. So if you look, first of all, at the ancestral primate, you find that the ancestral primate split up into lemurs, lorises, and patos, and you'll find that a lot of those are in Madagascar. Not only in Madagascar, but that's sort of a hot spot for these kind of organisms. So 55 million years or so ago is when those split off the main family tree of primates. The next ones that split off were tarsiers. Tarsiers are very small organisms, and they are sort of the archetypal primate that's around the trees and active at night. They have very large eyes, and they have hands that are very well adapted for grasping even the smallest branches. And so they're really, really agile when it comes to moving around in a three-dimensional environment at night. Now think about that. That's not trivial. Moving around in a three-dimensional environment is one thing, but to be able to do it reliably at night, that's a whole nother problem, right? And you find that most of the others, New World monkeys, Old World monkeys, gibbons, and so on, they're active by day and they go to sleep at night because they don't have these big eyes and they don't have the wherewithal to do well at night. So that's a big difference. Now, monkeys are primates that have a tail. So all of these have a tail, and the apes, that's what these are, they're the ones without the tail. So the difference between monkeys and apes is the tail. Now, gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, chimpanzees, and humans are together on this tree. We are indeed part of the great apes, if you will. But we are not a type of organism that derived from chimpanzees. We had a common ancestor with chimpanzees, and that common ancestry goes back to about 5 million years or so. So it wasn't like, okay, there were chimpanzees, and then something happened to the chimpanzees, and now come the humans. That's not how it happened. You had a common ancestor from which chimpanzees evolved and humans evolved. One of the things that's hilarious is people sometimes say, well, if there's this close relationship between chimpanzees and humans and, you know, there's all this evolution, then why don't you see anything that's halfway in between? I mean, you know, 50% human, 50% chimpanzee. Well, first of all, you have to start acknowledging that humans are actually 98% chimpanzee. If you look at the genetic makeup of humans and chimps, 98% is the same. So you're never going to get 50-50 if they are already 98% the same. Do you follow me? So that's an argument that just is not sustainable. So there are small but very important differences between the two, and these have to do with how these organisms, the humans and the chimpanzees and their respective ancestors, developed adaptations. We developed cognitive skills that chimpanzees don't have. Why? Well, because our environment changed and the chimpanzees' environment was different than ours. We moved. Chimpanzees didn't. They stayed in the forests. Humans moved away. So there's all kinds of differences, and the differences are definitely things that we can relate to natural selection and how adaptations are produced in this lineage. Now, to give you an introduction of what they are, here you have the ring-tailed lemur. So that would be the first of these. King Julian, right, from Madagascar, that's who that is. And you'll find lemurs in a variety of places, but the greatest diversity of lemurs is actually in Madagascar. And Madagascar has that great of a diversity of lemurs because it's a very old island, and it did not have the predators or the competitors that pushed out the lemurs in other places. So lemurs, you do have lemurs in parts of Southeast Asia and India. You do have some lemurs in coastal parts of Africa, but the greatest diversity is in Madagascar. Same thing, incidentally, with tarsiers. They're also in places like Africa and Southeast Asia and India, but the greatest diversity, once again, is in Madagascar for much the same reason. Now, if it all centers on Africa, Madagascar, and that area, well, that is where the family tree of primates ultimately came from. And then, of course, we have anthropoids, which includes everybody else, including monkeys and apes. So here is an example of apes, and of course, these are the ones that we're mostly familiar with. On the left is a New World, so that's a South American species. On the right is a Southeast Asian species, it's a macaque. And so clearly those are monkeys because they have tails. If you move further into the evolutionary tree, you get to apes. And so these are the apes that we normally recognize as clearly primates. And of course, the difference between us and them is that these guys are hairy all over and they tend to hang on the trees or walk on all fours. But not always. You find orangutans walking upright. You'll find chimpanzees walking upright. Chimpanzees use tools, so do orangutans and gorillas. So there's all kinds of ways by which you can acknowledge that they do have some ways to develop greater skills. And then, of course, as humans, we're just a very specialized form of these. Now, we have had about 5 million years, or we have been alone on this branch, away from all the other apes, for about 5 to 7 million years. And so the ancestor really is not something we know for sure. Certainly, it's not anything that's around anymore. And so chimpanzees and humans are actually two distinct branches of the anthropoid tree. Now, when you look at the genus Homo specifically, there are several species. And of course, we looked at some of their skulls in the lab yesterday. We know these from fossils, but that's not the only kinds of Homo we know. We actually have subfossils, meaning that they're kind of like the Egyptian mummies or some of the people that you find in the bogs in Denmark that have not fossilized so that all their tissues have been preserved and turned into minerals, but you still have the organic components left. And so both Neanderthals and the hobbit species called Homo floresiensis from Indonesia have subfossils, meaning that we can do DNA analysis, we can figure out, you know, what exactly they were, and they overlapped with humans. And that's rather interesting. So the pictures I show below, those are the Neanderthal and then the Flores man and then humans. So when you consider that, up to about 11,000, maybe 10,000 years ago, we had three types of humans around. 10,000 years ago. Now, that's not that long ago. If you consider Egyptian mummies, we have some of those from about 6,500 years ago. So there was a big, important development over a period of 3,500 years or so, something that brought Homo sapiens out from the dawn of humanity and made it the species that ultimately we see today. Now, if you look at the different skulls, then you can see how this worked. On the left is the time scale in million years, and you can see that there are some early fossils, and some of these, they still have many of the ape-like features that we would recognize. For example, they don't have the flat face that the genus Homo tends to have. So if you look at some of these species here, and you just go and draw a line through the front, you can see that there's still a lot sticking out in the front. Right? So if you draw this line there's a big brow too. Whereas if you look at humans and you take our forehead and you go straight down, it's pretty much a straight line. The nose sticks out just a tiny bit, but we don't have some of this other stuff sticking out. And so as a consequence, there is a significant amount of development, skull development, but also other skeletal features. And these are generally very easy to explain in terms of the developmental genes that create them. But here we have all the different species of Homo, beginning with the earliest, which was Homo habilis, which may actually be in a different genus altogether. But certainly here later, for about the last 2 million years or so, we've had the genus Homo. And then I threw in the new skull, Homo floresiensis, because that rounds out the three species that coexisted at some time. Now, just today, if you look at the website of the BBC News, you'll find that a paper was published in the journal Nature that describes another skull, a skull that's I think about 60,000 years old or so, which clearly shows human features and perhaps shows also a little genetic mixing with Neanderthals. And so those are some of the things that I find pretty exciting when, you know, I talk about something in the lecture and then right away there's something out in science. So I'd encourage you to take a look at that and see if you understand a little bit about what they say and what I've been talking about. All right, and that's the end of chapter 17.